Hey everybody, Blue Goblin here, the greatest goblin that ever lived, is here to do a comic book review for this particular week of September 2016. I want to thank y'all for watching. This will be my second attempt at doing this, because the first time I attempted to do this review, I had filmed it, I said all I wanted to say, and just as I hit the, as soon as I turned the camera off to get the video ready to be uploaded to YouTube, the camera fell over and it wiped out the whole video. So let me try this again. We're gonna go through Marvel, a couple of indies, and finish it off with DC. Now, for those of you who follow me on Twitter, I'm hoping you caught the free Marvel digital codes for comic books that I posted on there. I'm going to try to get back into doing that. There was only one Marvel comic that I couldn't do that for because, well, let's talk about it. We'll start off with All New X-Men number 13. And in here, when I pulled the little tab off to reveal the code, the tab got screwed up and I wasn't able to get all the code. The code was just wiped out. It was all torn up, so I couldn't get it. So I apologize for that. Hopeless and Bagley work on this. This issue right here felt like it was done strictly for comedic purposes. You got Heidi and Evan trying to find Bobby a boyfriend. And they go to this club, and it's like anything that can go wrong does go wrong. And they just go with the whole awkward, complete screwball dork approach with Iceman. It's like everything goes wrong. Either he's too shy, there are times he gives a little TMI, and then there are times where the two wingmen that are supposed to help him find a date, they end up accidentally stealing the spotlight from him, and he goes scurrying away to loneliness. When Bobby does eventually find a guy, wouldn't you know it, the dude just happens to be an Inhuman. I went, of course. You made Iceman a gay character, which I don't have a beef with that. That's fine. But you have the potential to hook him up with someone who happens to be an Inhuman when, at a time when Inhumans and mutants, they ain't getting along. So, damn it. But things get settled, and Bobby ends up getting the guy's phone number, and the issue ends with ID and Evan going too sweet to each other. Now, I looked at that and I went, they're speaking to me as a wrestling fan, because nowadays, a lot of people associate Too Sweet with the Bullet Club. You know, with guys like, you know, AJ Styles, Luke Gallows, Karl Anderson, Kenny Omega, the Young Bucks, Adam Cole. You know, guys like that, the Bullet Club. Whereas me, much older wrestling fans like myself, when we first saw this, and we first heard Too Sweet, what did we think of? That's right, baby. We thought, hey yo, NWO for life. Too Sweet. To me, Too Sweet will always be new world order. With all due respect to the Bullet Club and to Bullet Club fans, gotta go with NWO. But it was cool to see them go Too Sweet. Hey, come on, somebody Too Sweet me. Come on, somebody Too Sweet me. But all in all, a fun issue. I dug it. It was fun, and I liked it. 3.5 out of 5. Let's keep going with Black Panther number 6. Oh, this is really good. Really good stuff. Digging this. T'Challa. I feel for you, man. You got all this weight on your back. And it ain't vibranium. It's just pure, solid pressure of running a country. You are the king, yet there are you have followers who do not respect you, who defy you, yet you want to remain an honorable king, where you've got people in your council telling you, you should rule this way, you should rule that way. T'Challa needs to sit down and just tell everybody, hey, everybody shut the hell up. I'm going to rule my own way, damn it. But, like he's going to say it like that. But in the meantime, you got Shuri still in the spirit world, and she's, I don't know where they're going with that. But the antagonists that we are seeing in here, they're just really, really cocky and really arrogant. And I think that's a bit of a plus. You know, sometimes cocky and arrogant villains can make an entertaining story out of something that's meant to be so serious. But this is really good stuff. I'm still really enjoying this. Not the biggest Black Panther fan in the world, but I want to give him a chance. And I'm thinking I made the right call jumping on board with this series. But this has just been simply fun stuff. I like it. 3.5. Let's move on to... Let's see if I can pour as much passion into my review as I tried to do the first time when I talk about Civil War II Amazing Spider-Man number 4, the finale of this little mini-series in which Pete's trying to reason through with Clash and it's just not registering. Clash feels like he should just be his own man. And I gotta say, Clash's outfit just looks badass. I like it. You know, Pete tries to combat him with some old tech that he used on him back when he was in his rookie years, and Clash is able to just shake that off and go, I've kind of upgraded since then. And then the kicker. The main selling point of this issue was Peter's monologue to Clash about, you know, taking responsibility. Peter took Carol Danvers' bullshit logic of stopping things before they happen and made it sound more logical. The way Peter describes the urgency of being responsible, the way he describes it, he's way more convincing at it than Carol Danvers will ever be. Captain Marvel can kiss my ass. To me, stopping something from happening by punishing somebody for something they haven't done yet, for something they're not even aware that they're going to do yet, that's not taking responsibility. That is playing the role of God, which is a role no one should have. That's not being an officer of the law. That's not being a hero. I'm sorry, but in this Civil War II storyline, Carol, Captain Marvel, is clearly in my heart. My heart and my brain are telling me she is the villain. Whereas Peter, who's standing by her for some God only knows reason, he takes that argument and makes it more believable. Because in his eyes, stopping something from happening should not include prosecuting somebody for something they haven't done. Instead, when you get a vision, or when you know something's going to happen, or if you're told something's going to happen, strategize, plan out, talk to people, come up with plans, contingency plans, do whatever you have to do before the moment happens. Wait for your opportunity to take action against said threat instead of getting rid of the threat before the threat is even aware of its existence. That's taking away choice. That's taking away freedom. It's just simply not fair. Whereas Tony has the right idea. Maybe if something is meant to happen, then it should happen. If something is meant to be stopped, then go back to my argument, plan out, strategize. Don't think about the bigger consequence. When somebody's causing trouble, simply stop them. Don't stop them before they choose to do something bad. I've rambled on too long about this and about this issue. This issue was fine for what it was, but y'all get the gist of what I'm saying. A 3.5. Let's move on to Gods of War number 4. It's basically Hercules and the gods of old whipping some new god ass. And that's pretty much it. Dan Abnett does a great job with the writing, telling the story, and God only knows Lyso's artwork helps tell the story beautifully with the artwork. It's just a very predictable finish, but still a finish I enjoy nonetheless, and this has been a solid storyline. Really digging it. This Gods of War miniseries has been really surprisingly good. There's been some highs, and there's been some lows. I think the lowest part of this story was when Carol's telling, basically threatening Hercules just to look big in front of everybody else, which that just really pissed me off. Captain Marvel, Carol Danvers, she was such a bitch in this series. But the story, I thought, concluded very well despite the predictability. I mean, you really think they're going to build all this stuff up just to have Hercules and them lose? Especially when Hercules is going to be in so many other titles. It just didn't... I never thought for a second that they were going to lose. But despite the predictability is not always bad. This was actually very nicely done. Solid read. Give it a 3.5 as well. Let's move on to Gwenpool number 6. Hastings, Strachowski, and Rosenberg, everybody who worked on this, you're doing a good job with this. My only problem with this particular issue is that I don't know whether I should look at Gwenpool as a hero or a villain. She came off a little bit more villainish than she did heroic, because she tries to use deadly force on a minor threat, but she's still looking at this world that she's in as strictly a comic book world. But you gotta think, Gwen, you're in this world now too, which makes you part of it. Even in this so-called comic book world, there are still consequences for every action you take, whether the actions are good or bad, or whether you had good or bad intentions. Just because it's a make-believe world, that doesn't mean that there's not any law and order or consequences. It's just there were times I thought Gwen just came off like she just didn't care, or if she thought, well, this is a comic book world, I ain't gonna get in trouble and all that, blah, blah, blah. Even Miles Morales is questioning her sanity by the end of the issue, as well as he should. I still say that Gwenpool was Marvel's answer to Harley Quinn. I still stand by that belief, unless Marvel does something very drastically different with the character later on down the line long term. But this was still a fun issue nonetheless, despite the head scratching with the character development in this particular issue. Good for what it was. I'll give it a 3 at the best. Let's move on to Spider-Man number 8, Bendis and Leon. Y'all are doing good with this, especially you, Mr. Bendis. Great writing. The artwork in here was good. What really sells this particular issue was the heartbreak on Miles Nova and Ms. Marvel's faces when they realized just what kind of ordeal that they find themselves in with this whole struggle between Tony and Carol, because this is their first big glimpse into this new Civil War, and they see what happens to Bruce Banner. And you can just, you don't even really have to read the dialogue. You can just, especially with Ms. Marvel, you can just look at her face, the way she's drawn and the way the shading is done, the way the story and the plot is paced in this issue, you can really see that this person that she idolized, this person she worshipped, she wanted to be her, she now is doubting whether or not she should still look up to her. You can tell she's heartbroken and disappointed at the same time. Whereas Miles and Nova are also heartbroken and disappointed, and it's like, are they really fighting on the right side? But I don't think anybody showed more pain than Ms. Marvel. Her hero did something despicable, and it hurt her so much to see it. That is really solid storytelling. When you can just look at a picture, when you can just look at a panel, without even having to read the dialogue, and instantly know what the hell's going on, that's a success. This was a good, dramatically heavy issue. Nicely done, Mr. Bendis, and especially to Leon for the great artwork. This was fantastic. It gets a 4. All right, let's finish off Marvel with Spider-Man 2099, number 15. Peter David and Mr. Sliney. Okay, this storyline has been going all over the place. Miguel's trying to restore his 2099 back to the way it was before he started doing all this time jumping and everything. You know, Punisher's no longer Punisher. We're seeing some stuff with the new Daredevil, the new Doc Strange, the new Moon Knight. It's like he's trying to figure out some stuff about the new Moon Knight, and it's like, they're like, if we tell you anything about her, we'll have to kill you. And it's like, oh, that's not really funny. And they go, that's not a joke. Wow. But what really, it's like, with the shocking arrival of the Power Pack last issue and seeing the Power Pack in action in here, that was some good stuff too. But the cherry on top was the cliffhanger. The reveal of who Alchemax's new CEO is, or who the CEO is in this alternate timeline. Oh my God. Mr. David. I need a drag. Holy shit. I've always called you the master of cliffhangers, and you've earned that nickname from me for a reason. I almost couldn't process it. That reveal. Damn! Now I get it. Now it makes almost perfect sense why superheroes in this alternate timeline are now outlawed. They seemed like they were being outlawed just for the sole reason that they are heroes or supers. Supers are outlawed, whether they are good or bad. But when I saw that last page, then I was like, oh, of course, it makes sense now. But I just gotta know. I gotta know. I've got a bitch of an itch for the next couple of issues. Where did that come from? Where are you going with this? I have to know. Mr. David, I thank you. This was great. That cliffhanger knocked the wind out of me. This was amazing. A solid 4 out of 5. Let's go on to the indie stuff. We're going to Boom Studios with Mighty Morphin Power Rangers Pink, number 3 of 6. Fletcher Thompson, Howard DiNiculo, and Stern, everybody that worked on this, you're doing a great job. And maybe it says a lot to me. You know, the Pink Ranger was never my favorite Ranger. In fact, I always thought Trini was hotter than Kimberly was when I was growing up. But I gotta say, when the series started, I had semi-low expectations, but I was still intrigued. I wanted to know what kind of story you could tell here. And now we're up to issue 3, and I can't get enough of this. This is great stuff. That big reveal in issue 2 where Goldar's new Zord is 90% made up of the broken pieces of the old Thunder Zords. And I was like, after 20 years, we finally got an answer. Excuse me. After 20-something years, we finally got an answer. What happened to the old Thunder Zords when they got busted up at the beginning of Season 3? When they came back with their ninja powers, the broken Thunder Zords that were just sitting there burning up and blowing up, they just vanished. I know it's a TV show, there's not supposed to be that much logic in it, damn it. But when you got a comic book series like this, plus the main series that Boom does with this franchise, there's more logic, there's more explanations, there's better storytelling. And I'm digging this. This is really good. But I like the fact that Goldar's working on his own. He's still doing this stuff without Rita and Zed's knowledge. And it's almost as if he really doesn't care if they know. I mean, it's a testament to how wicked this character is. It makes me wonder if he's by building up some sort of scheme to maybe overthrow him or something, like that'll never happen. But it's just really, really well done. We get a big twist at the end, and Kimberly, along with the surprising return of Zack and Trini, they're in pretty much deep shit by the end of the issue. This is still very nicely done. Yeah, I forgot to mention that. Yeah, in the last issue, Kimberly tracked down Zack and Trini, and they are once again alongside her as Power Rangers. Just on borrowed power from the old Sword of Light. Still, fun as hell. Love it. It's great. I'll give it a 4 out of 5. Oh, Christ. We're going to Boundless Comics, and I only got this because it was the honorable thing to do. It was already ordered for me because the first issue was such crap and so boring that I was like, oh, one issue of it, and I'm already done. But before issue one even came out, I had ordered this one, and it was ordered. I was like, all right, I'll go ahead and get it. Jungle Fantasy Ivory number 2. This was just as dull as the first issue was. I know it says a lot since this is a very adult-themed comic book, but man, this was just as bad as the first issue. It might arguably be worse. Whereas the first issue, this is dealt the same way. Just nothing but a bunch of sexy pinup art to tell a story. It's another one of those books where it's like two separate stories. The first story was told with nothing but pinup art, single page pinup art, and a bunch of dialogue boxes. And that doesn't tell a story. I mean, and I don't want to hear anybody get on to me about, well, you read Tarot, Witch of the Black Rose. Yes, I do. But the difference between Tarot and this, at least with Tarot, you have a continuity that has been spread out throughout from issue one all the way up till now. You have a continuing story. You have well-developed characters. You have a very well-drawn-out plot, a good pacing. You know, despite all the sexy art that they use, at least Tarot has that. This does not have it. All this was just porn on paper, and it just wasn't any good at all. I was bored with it. And the second story, you have your main character. It's just like issue one was, where your main character, your protagonist, your heroine, so to speak, is still looking like a damsel in distress. It didn't work when Marvel did this shit with Miles Morales, and Boundless ain't gonna get away with doing it with their main character either. This was lame, it was dull, it didn't hardly tell me any story at all. The artwork, yes, it was nice, but it takes more than nice artwork to tell me a story. And I'm trying not to yawn just thinking about it. I'm going to just say this was below an average read. I'm going to give it a 2 out of 5. It was crap. Let's go on to DC. Start off the DC stack with Action Comics 963, Superman, Meet Clark Kent. part one. Dan Juergens, still doing a great job. Loving this. I'm still ready to see the explanation as to how there is a non-Superman Clark Kent running around. I'm ready to see the explanation. Please, for the love of God, don't make it a clone. Don't let it be a clone. That'll just kill me. But I like what they're doing with this particular Clark Kent. Much like when Clark was Superman, you know, he was still willing to go out of his way to get a good story for the Daily Planet. In here, this Clark Kent comes off like a male Lois Lane, putting his life in danger just to get a story. He must be onto something, because the people he's trying to get the story about are out to kill him.
Lisa, see Lois Lane.
Looked like a man. But, of course, Big Blue saves his own ass, I guess. And the big cliffhanger at the end is, we need to talk. So the next issue, they're gonna talk. I can't wait to see this talk. This is very entertaining. This is really good stuff. I loved it. I thought it was fun. I'd give it a 4.
All right. Time for some All-Star Batman.
All-Star Batman number 2. You know, only Scott Snyder and John Romita Jr. could get away with a $5 Batman comic and it'd be good. I don't want to give too much away with this. This was really good. What I will say is that Bruce is still sticking to his persistent plan to get Two-Face to where he needs to get him. But while he's doing that, James Gordon, back in Gotham, let's just say he found something. Let's just say he found something big. I can't say anymore. This was fantastic. Mr. Snyder and Mr. Romita, you did a fantastic job with this. The writing is solid. The artwork is beautiful. John Romita Jr. is one of my favorite comic book artists of all time. I personally prefer his artwork in The Amazing Spider-Man, but since he's now working with DC, I can handle him working with Batman. I just have one request. Just one request. You're going to have to draw Joker sooner or later. I'd like to see that. But still, solid read, nonetheless. That cliffhanger. Jesus Christ. That cliffhanger. 4.5 out of 5. That was excellent. Moving on to Bombshells number 17. This is part 1 of Uprising. Bombshells has devised a plan to get the Jews safely away from the Nazis by getting them out of the ghettos and everything. Good storytelling. I wouldn't say this was fun, because this was kind of like a Holocaust movie scare tactic, whatever kind of story you want to describe it as. But every bombshell's done very well in here. There's a really good scene with Zatanna and Raven. Raven. Really good scene in there. Harley has a good moment. Batwoman is developed very well. And we finally get to see a bombshell when... this was a character I've been wanting to see in the bombshell world, and we finally got her. Mary Marvel. I'll go ahead and spoil that. We finally get Mary Marvel. her bombshell counterpart. She looks amazing. This was good. A really good issue, but with a kind of oh boy kind of ending. Fantastic stuff. It's not the best issue of Bombshells that I've read. By far, no, it's not. But this was fun. It was thrilling. I dug it. The action was good. The character development was very good. For the most part, I give it a 3.5. I had a feeling I'm probably going to get some negative feedback for this. But y'all know me. I'm brutally honest and I tell it like it is. I'm not going to be a sheep and just say, hey, this book was great because some other people on the internet said it was great. I'm not going to do that. Detective Comics 940. This book pissed me off. Let me explain why. Without giving too much away, because I don't want to spoil it. James Tynion IV. Usually, when you're writing a Batman-related book, I'm there. But what in the hell was this? You give us a blockbuster moment. You give us a moment that we should be able to remember for years and years and years to come. You give us a moment that could instantly be legendary. You give us that. And you had the potential to make this issue one of the single most memorable issues in the entire historic library of DC Comics. You had that potential with this book. And you blew it! How did you blow it? I don't know if you asked that, but I'm going to tell you anyway. You give us this big moment, and it nearly brought a tear out of me. I shit you not. But then we get to the end of the book. What a damn cop-out. The ending of this book should have been saved for at least 2 or 3 years. Because of what you gave us in this issue, you took this potentially legendary moment and you retconned it just moments later. You didn't need to. You disappointed me so bad that the next time you ever try to tease us with a moment like the one you gave us in here, the next time you tease it, it's not going to be as impactful. It will never be as impactful as this, as you tried to make this one be. I'll never be able to fully emotionally buy into it because of what you did in here. The finish felt lazy, it felt safe, and it felt like you risked a lot with the moment you got in there and you were like, you kind of like you wussed out and said, oh wait, we can't do it after all. If you're gonna do something as big as you tried to do in here, go all the way with it. Go balls to the wall. Grow a spine and go with it. Who knows what kind of long-term ramifications we can get from this? Maybe there'll be more positives than negatives. We'll certainly get some negatives from it. This could have been one of those issues that would have been talked about for years and years and years to come. Oh, I'm sure this issue is being talked about, but I bet it's being talked about for the wrong reason. Because you wussed out and you gave us that fanboy freaking cop-out finish just so you wouldn't piss off any fans. Sometimes us comic book fans, trust me, I know, sometimes us comic book fans need to get pissed off from time to time to keep our interest there. Sometimes it doesn't always work. Sometimes when we get offended or we feel insulted, we get away from it. Or we draw a little more closer to it, hoping that the decisions you make turn out for the better long term. If you didn't have that cop-out finish in here, this could have possibly been a perfect 5-star book. But because you copped out, because someone ripped your balls off and you decided not to go that route, it knocks it down to an average read at best at 2.5. Very. One of the most disappointing issues of Detective Comics I've read in years. And I'm saying that straight from the heart. Let's move on to Earth 2 Society, number 16, Last Stand Against the Ultra Humanite. A bunch of fists are flying, a bunch of yelling is done, Green Lantern's going crazy, and by the end of the issue, a big box opens up and everything turns white. Skippy skip, whoop-de-doo, I don't care. This was once one of the hottest titles on the shelves, and by now, I just don't care anymore. I'm just gonna finish it out. Once Rebirth starts, I'm done with this. Simple as that. You got heroes in here who don't act like heroes. You got heroes in here that love to bitch a lot, love to take control a lot. They have good looks, but they just don't have the same qualities that make good heroes at times. It's just, I've reached the point where I just don't care anymore. 2.5 average. Let's move on to The Flash, number 6. Call him Death. Call him Godspeed. A lot of drama. This was heavy on the drama. Barry is just beside himself. He's just at his wits' end, trying to figure out what happened to his new girlfriend. Meanwhile, you got Wally flipping out when he finds out what happened to Mina. Mina was going to be his mentor, his personal teacher, and teaching him how to use the Speed Force. But him having the Speed Force is something Barry and Iris don't know yet. But it's coming. They're going to find out. All kinds of negative dramas happening in here, including some of the new Speedsters wanting the Flash to take the powers back because they fear for their lives. Godspeed is targeting Speedsters. And by the end of the issue, we see who Godspeed is. Well played, DC. Well played, Mr. Williamson. Very well played. I should have seen that coming. I really should have. I feel like I should have. But I didn't. I genuinely and honestly did not see that coming. Wow. You got me. This was good. I give it a 4. Green Lantern's number 6. Humphreys, Conrad, Herbert, and Blonde. Good stuff. This is really good stuff. This issue, though, does kind of reek of plot convenience. It's like her back's against the wall. She's literally backed into the corner, and then just like that, she's able to learn how to make constructs with her ring. Jessica Cruz. She's able to make a construct, and she just so happens to figure out how to build a construct so bad that she takes down the Red Lantern's tower. Now that's what I call some damn beginner's luck. your first construct and you win. Wow. That's something, I don't even think that's something Hal Jordan or Guy Gardner or even John Stewart have done. Okay. Fair enough. A little plot convenient, but fine. It's fine. It's like they think they've won the day, but in reality, they may not have. Meanwhile, we have the rogue Guardian show off something a little shiny to the Green Lanterns, but I'm not going to ruin what it is. This was a decent issue. Like I said, a little convenient, but it was still good for what it was. I'll give it a 3.5. Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps, number 4, Mr. Venditti and Ethan Van Sciver on the artwork. This was good. Probably the shining star of this issue was Sinestro. Woo! What a bastard! You disobey him? You fail a mission? He doesn't scold you. No. He doesn't lecture you. No. Damn it, he'll kill you! And that's what he did. Yeah. It's like one of his loyal members of the Sinestro Corps says, "Hey, we brought you a Green Lantern." And Sinestro's like, "Ah, great, you brought me Hal Jordan. I'm ready to torture him." And he's like, "Wait, you brought me Guy Gardner. I told you to bring me Hal Jordan. But Sinestro, we thought we brought you a Green Lantern." Kills him. That is badass. It's true to form, true to character Sinestro. Just don't give a shit. He made a specific order. You fail, you die. Great. Meanwhile, Hal's actually being held by Sinestro's daughter secretly. And she's actually trying to heal him after his little skirmish with the Sinestro Corps members that he had. Meanwhile, Sinestro is trying to intimidate Guy Gardner while Guy Gardner is naked. Guy is powerless up against the wall, but he still finds a way to look badass. He's like, "Give me my backpack." And Sinestro's like, "Yeah, at least put some clothes on." So the first thing he does, he pulls out a beer. And even you got Sinestro comedically going, "How did the Green Lanterns ever pick you?" Yeah, it's just, this was fun, horrific, and dramatic all at the same time. This was really good. I give it a 4. Superwoman number 2. Bill Jimenez and Santarelli. Yeah, I wasn't really feeling this issue, to be honest. I wasn't. I was kind of let down you decided to kill Superwoman off in the very first issue. Now, granted, there are two Superwomen. You had Lois Lane, the new 52 Lois Lane, by the way. She was Superwoman. She had Superman's basic powers, the super strength, the heat vision, the frost breath, the flight, and all that stuff. She had the basic Superman powers. Whereas you have New 52 Lana Lang, she's the other Superwoman. She has, hers a little more throwback to the 90s. Her Superwoman powers that she got from Superman was his short-lived electronic powers, his electric powers, which, back when Superman's powers were based off electricity, that was interesting. I'll give it that. And he had a bitchin' costume. But when you think of Superman, you really, not too many people remember the electric Superman. And that's basically what she looks like, even though she does have some of the more basic Superman Kryptonian powers. But in here, she does fine as Superwoman. all kinds of crazy stuff is going on in here. It just wasn't really keeping my attention until the cliffhanger. Whew. Okay. Now you got my attention. Now I'm ready to see where you go with this. Not bad. Not great. Just kind of there. I mean, one big cliffhanger at the end of a meh book, it's not enough to give it a big boost in my eyes. So I'll be fair and give it above average, but not really that great. I'll give it a 3 out of 5. Let's end this video with Wonder Woman number 6. Greg Rucka, Nicola Scott. Wow. This was good. This is the next part of the year one storyline, in which we get another retelling of Diana's origin, and she's now in the world of man. She's still speaking her, you know, ancient Greek tongue. She doesn't know English. And I'm glad that we didn't have any of that dialogue that suggested that anybody who doesn't understand English or can't speak it, I'm glad we didn't have anybody look like they would just go to her and start speaking louder to hope they understand. How many of you have seen that, where you see somebody talking to a foreigner or to somebody that doesn't know English, can't speak it, can't understand it, and you say something to them and they don't know what you're saying, and you just say, you go up to somebody and they say, hey, you want a pizza? Do you want a pizza? Speaking louder does not make them understand. So I'm thankful we didn't get any of that. That would have been forceful comedy, and that doesn't always work. So instead, they do some investigating. They have her in a holding cell because, you know, then again, you know, humans fear what they don't get, what they don't understand, and all that bullshit. So they do some of their investigating. They find out what her tongue is. It's like ancient Greeks. Like, nobody's really spoken this language in God knows how long. But they found someone who can speak it just good enough to translate, you know, Diana's words to everybody. And this is where we start seeing Diana show off all her gifts that she was given before leaving Themyscira, you know, her strength and all that stuff. I mean, this was just a fun read. Diana comes off so naive, yet tries to be so trusting and loving. It's true to who Wonder Woman is. And I thought Greg Rucka and Nicola Scott did a fantastic job telling the story with great writing, good pacing, good character development, and beautiful artwork. This was a gem. I loved this issue. This was so good. It easily gets a 4.5 for me. Well, hopefully this video will be good enough to upload. Hopefully I won't have to do this again. Thanks for watching, everybody. I hope y'all enjoyed it. Please subscribe. Don't forget Blue Goblin X. Don't forget Arkham Asylum Studio. Follow me here on YouTube or on Facebook, Twitter, and Pinterest. I think I'm pretty much done with Tumblr. I think I'm just going to keep it up to, you know, talk with friends that I've made on there, even though I haven't spoken to them in God knows how long. Tumblr has just become an outright mess. I'm sick of all the porn bots following me. I'm done with it. But don't forget my bros, the Mount Vernon Kid, Del Pilzilla, and Brandon Hex, as always. Thanks again for watching, everybody. Hail Hydra. Too sweet. And I'll see y'all later.